This is actually 5 separate projects that I'll be talking about, so this is going to be somewhat of a manic presentation. I'm going to be putting slides up there and not talking about stuff on them, but you guys can all read. I assume you can all read, right? So we'll make it through this. You can see the team. We have a very expansive team of researchers, plus a team of staff, which you'll see on the acknowledgement slide at the end. But you can see from the people from our Harbor branch will know that we've got a bunch of biologists that specialize in all sorts of different specialties, and we have engineers working on this project as well. It's a very integrated project. The individual SLP-funded projects are very integrated into an overall project that we call the Umbrella Project. All right, so talk about integrated multi-trophic aquaculture very quickly at first. There's a concept of integrated multi-trophic aquaculture that's been applied in open ocean aquaculture, whereby the waste from fed aquaculture is used as resource to feed other species, that being filter feeders, detritus feeders, plants, etc. There's a group of scientists that are bringing this onto land-based systems. Most of them are using a linear design similar to what I'm showing here. The thing about the linear design is it's simple, but you have to flow all of the water from the fed culture through all the other components, which makes it difficult if you have sensitive species and that sort of thing to effectively culture, or it also reduces a subset of species that you can actually use within the culture. A sensitive species is not going to be able to be applied in this system. All right, here's an example of a linear system that's being used in Egypt. They're actually doing fed culture here, and it flows through the system, and in this instance, rather than recirculating back, it's actually discharging to the open ocean, which is one of the methods for using this type of concept. Well, in our concept, we wanted to have a much more expansive group of species that we could look at, target sensitive species, things like that, that may be used for food or for stock enhancement. Okay, so we chose to use a design with a centralized filtration system and spokes. So you have a hub of filtration with spokes to different culture components. So here you have the fed culture, and being the fish and shrimp in this case, extractive culture for suspended solids, being a filter feeder, in our instance, oysters was a species that we chose, extractive culture for settleable solids, being urchins, which we chose, and we're using a local species of urchin, and then assimilative culture being the culture of seaweed in our case. All right, so the design is more complex. Water flow is distributed and can be put to any component in the quantity that component needs, which makes the system a little bit more usable, gives you kind of a plug-and-play mode, much more expandable, much more flexible for design with the different species, and overall should improve the efficiency of a traditional recirculating, land-based recirculating system, because you're using these wastes now as resources instead of discharging them. All right, so this is the design that we put together for our prototype in conjunction with our engineering group. That's why we have real nice 3D modeling designs, thanks to them. And it was very interesting, as aquaculturists know, you know, we build from like Legos from the ground up and make everything fit. But with this concept is very nice. It made it much speedier to do the designs and get it together, order parts, etc. All right. The other thing is we were able to do a very complex integrated computerized control system. Now, I've done these by myself on some of our systems, but this is a degree above what I've done myself previously, and it's working very well. Another thing that we did, one of the main things that we knew from the beginning is, how are we going to handle these solids? What are we going to do with these solids? All right. And the final iteration for us at this point is a system called an ex-situ biofloc reactor. What we found, and you'll see when I talk about the urchin component, is that the urchins don't necessarily like to eat the poo, we'll call it, coming from the fish. All right, so there's some research out there that has shown that you can convert the poo into a bacterial colony now, like yogurt, all right, and then you use that to feed the animals, okay? So what are some of the potential products? The ones that are highlighted in dark blue are the species we're looking at. obviously fish, multiple different species of fed culture for fish, shrimp, either for food or for bait. All right, and these can be done in clean water or a bioflock culture. Of course, clean water would be very simple in the system, so we chose to do bioflock culture because it's more difficult. Why take the easy road, right? So I'm going to talk about shrimp very briefly. Here's the group that worked on that. They did the three basic experiments. One was done in replicated fashion in using fish solids. All right, and what they found is that by applying fish solids, we were actually able to get the bioflock, which is a bacterial culture and takes a lot of time to get established in a traditional sense. But by using fish solids, we were able to get that bioflock established much quicker. And you can see that expressed by the green line being no fish solids versus having fish solids in these lines. And the shrimp actually grew as well, regardless of which method we used. That was not a system that was integrated into the IMTA. That was while we were designing and developing the system, we did that replicated experiment. So after we had the system together, the prototype, we did two actual production runs using that concept. The first experiment didn't use the fish solids or the solids coming out of the system. And the second experiment did use, since it's a prototype, there's only one tank, so we had to do an iterative kind of experiment, more of an empirical design. But we were able to actually effectively integrate fish culture in a bioflock sense to our IMTA, which we were very happy with. And we're actually running a fourth production run right now where we're using an alternative concept to deliver the solids to the shrimp. And it's working, it seems to be working out. We don't have data at this point, but it seems to be working out very well. So on to other potential products from our extractive cultures. We have settleable solids, the sea urchins. All right, this is the sea urchin we're working with, Lytokinus variegatus. And then suspended solids would be oysters. And I'm going to get into some of the things we've done. This is the team that has worked on that, including John and Amber, Freddie Prawl, and an intern who did an exciting project for us that really stimulated our research, the direction of our research. He was a summer intern. He's sitting right there. Very, very good project. So on the urchin side, we were looking at the flocculation as a means of concentrating solids so that we could get at them and use them. We were looking at means of moving solids. So this shows the integration between that umbrella project and the urchin portion. And this goes for all the components of the project, very integrated. All right, there's that's poo and that's pre-yogurt, yeah. This is actually how we collect the yogurt. But what we found is that the dried solids, we actually took the solids, dried them down in a drying oven, and then attempted to feed that to the urchins to see if they would even accept it. They did not accept it. They did not like it. This is what led us then to go towards this ex situ bioflock mode of dealing with the solids. All right, and now that we've got that system working very well, we're going to, with our current set of interns, we're going to start looking at that yogurt as a feed, acceptance of it, and et cetera, for the urchins. All right, oysters. This is the study that Matt did. We were looking at the use of fine particulates by oysters. This is his data. All right, looked at feeding oysters the fish suspended solids, and then a combination of algae plus suspended solids. And you can see just on the suspended solids, they did not grow very well. But when we added algae, they grew well. And if you look at this, the fish suspended 50-50 algae plus fish suspended algae did not grow significantly different from just algae, which you would normally be growing oysters on. So they can use the suspended solids, but there's something missing. And when you looked at the oysters themselves, the ones that were supplemented were developing gonads, which shows that they're healthy. So we expanded on that, on the work that he did it for us as an intern in the subsequent year, doing it at large scale within the integrated system. These are the tanks that we operated in. We saw that we were actually showing an increase over time, and we thought that we needed, based on his work, And what we were seeing, we wanted to add microalgae. Here's some pictures of microalgae and some funny guy looking at them. Two types of oysters we had available to us for this study were some that were in the IMTA system for a period of time prior to the study, and then some that were kept out of the IMTA and supplementally fed with algae for a period. All right, so we had two treatment groups, two troughs, et cetera, and the results showed that supplementation with algae worked, all right, based on live weight and weight change of the oysters. So we knew we need to supplement, all right, the oysters with microalgae in order to get good, healthy growth. So the question then came, can we integrate the growth of microalgae into the system? We did another sub-study using water from the IMTA in batch culture and determined that the water would support growth of algae. So year three is to look at how do we integrate this in a loop or some sort of continuous batch culture to produce algae for oyster supplementation. All right, assimilative culture in the macroalgae, we were looking at ulva and gracilaria. And if you look at the assimilative culture as a whole, it can be used as two things: produce the product directly and sell it, or produce it and use it as feed for one of the other animals in the system. All right, so now you've biotransformed it into something much like our yogurt has been biotransformed to something to feed something in the system. So these are some results that Dennis had from previous work out on our algae slab, an area that he does flow-through culture of algae. And he has some data on how algae performs over the course of a year. We are collecting essentially the same sort of data on our system to get production rates and getting tissue so we can do nitrogen sampling. This is what our actual data on the IMTA looks like based on production. So we are getting a similar trend to what we saw in the flow-through culture in our IMTA. This is theoretical data. All right, currently the samples are out to get the real numbers that'll replace this. And basically this information is going to allow us to start to model how nutrients are moving throughout the system, how much nitrogen the plants can remove, how many plants we need, et cetera, based on the weight of the fish that we're feeding. All right, we do have problems that we're trying to address. And the results of this project have produced a lot of outreach components. Incorporation of the concepts and in real time what we're learning from these systems into our FAU courses, our IRSC courses, our ACTED courses and workshops, etc. A presentation at the 9th International Recirculating Aquaculture Conference, which is basically we went and told them what we're doing so that they know that we're the ones doing this concept, because this is a concept that was developed here. The idea was developed here by our team of biologists and engineers. We did three presentations at the World Aquaculture Society meeting this past fall, and then two presentations at Northeastern Aquaculture Conference Exposition. We've got two linked intern projects, Matt's project and another project looking at particulates within the system. Two articles in Aquaculture Industry Press and many lay articles. So we're getting the word out about this system and the work that we're doing. And this is the acknowledgments. You can see it's a very big group of people, as well as the scientists that are working on the project. So, one question. All right. One question, make it a good one. Split among the 2 years, the total budget was $338,000.